Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest. Permit me to pass the ultimate test.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters, I'd like to welcome you to another live edition of your program, Ask Huda. Our phone numbers, beginning with area code, are 002-0238-555-131 or 132, and the Facebook page is Dr. Muhammad Salah Official. Thank God we didn't have pending questions from the previous episode, but we have a long list of email questions and questions that I received on the page. The first one is from Bint Abdul Rahman. She says, in case of khula, is the wife obliged to also pay back the money spent on the walima, wedding, or is it the mahr or the dowry only? As we understand that the legitimacy of al-khula, which is that the wife would ransom herself and get separated from her husband for a compensation to pay back to her husband the dowry that he paid her in order to marry her, is prescribed, and it is something that happened at the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him, when the wife of Thabit ibn Qais, may Allah be pleased with all of them, came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she said that she cannot tolerate living with him, even though she admired his faith, his religious commitment, and his manners, but she couldn't live with him. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَتَرُدِّينَ عَلَيْهِ حَدِيقَتَهُ, because he had paid her a bustan, a garden, as a dowry. So he said, would you be willing to give him back his garden? She said, certainly. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered him to give her one single divorce and to accept back his garden. Now, there is a difference of opinion between the scholars with regards to what if the husband demands more than the dowry. In this case, the sister is saying that the cost of the walima and the wedding and all of that. Well, there is a difference of opinion with regards to whether it is permissible to pay more than the dowry to the husband in order to get khula or not. According to Imam Ahmad, it is not permissible. And in one of his views, it is disliked. So according to the school of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, it's either not permissible or disliked. We have Al-Imam Malik and Imam Shafi'i, may Allah have mercy on them, are of the view that it is permissible as long as they both agree to that. Why? They both, all the schools of thoughts, relied on the same reference, number 229 of Surah Al-Baqarah, which begins with At-talaqu marratani fa'imsakum bima'rufin aw tasrihun bi'ihsan. Then in the ayah, Allah the Almighty says, فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا يُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا فِي مَفْتَدَتْ بِهِ. The meaning of this ayah and some more after this question, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum. After this call. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Tahir from Sudan. Assalamu alaikum. Akhi Tahir. Tahir. Okay, we lost that call. Try again. فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا يُقِيمَ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. Allah the Almighty prescribed al-khul'a in this ayah, ayah number 229, in case that the man is a good husband, but the wife cannot tolerate living with him for a psychological matter, for a matter of love and affection. She cannot develop this love and affection towards him, and she feels that she cannot live with him. So there is nothing wrong with him. He doesn't beat her. He doesn't He actually supports her financially. He is very nice to her. He's a man who fulfills his duties towards Allah and towards his family. In this case, if the wife refuses to live with this man, give him back his dowry. So, a divorce, which is with a compensation, whether it is a dowry more or less, then that is called khul'a, and it's irrevocable. So once he gives a single divorce and accepts back the dowry or any form of compensation, she becomes divorced, and there is no right for the man to take her back within the iddah, because this divorce is irreversible. But the khilaf is only concerning whether he has the right to ask for more than what he has paid as a dowry. And I mentioned the difference of opinion in this regard. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Tahir from Sudan is back on the line. Assalamu alaikum. Okay, one more time. Please try again, Brother Tahir. Sister Rabia Wan says in her question, is there any sunnah way of cutting nails? I mean, any sequence which we need to follow to cut nails of hands and feet? What is recommended, what is mustahab when it comes to clipping one's nails, is to begin always with the right hand. That is something that has been stated in the sound hadith. Aisha radiallahu anha narrated that كَانَ يُعْجِبُهُ التَّيَمُّنُ فِي تَنَعُلِهِ وَتَرَجُّلِهِ وَطُهُورِهِ وَفِي شَأْنِهِ كُلِّهِ. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to like to begin with the right hand in every aspect, in tana'ulihi, like wearing his shoes, wearing, putting on his sandals. He would begin with the right foot. Combing his hair, the right side first. وَطُهُورِهِ, and he would wash, whenever he would wash for wudu or for ghusl, he would begin with the right side first. Then she said, وَفِي أَمْرِهِ كُلِّهِ, and in every matter, except in one thing, which is entering the bathroom or al-khala. Then he would enter with the left foot, not with the right foot. And he would step out with the right foot though. So it is recommended accordingly to begin by clipping your nails of the right hand or the right foot. There are some ahadith, but none of them is confirmed, none of them is sound, pertaining to the sequence. Al-Imam al-Nawawi spoke in this regard, and he said to begin with whichever finger first, then second and third. And there are some ahadith, as I said, they are not sound. But just to share with you why the sister asked this question, to begin with al-khinsar, then the middle finger, then al-ibham. So with the little one, then you skip this one, you go to the middle, you go to the thumb, then you go back to the second, to the little finger, then to al-sababa or al-musabbiha, which we point out with in the tashahud. But as I say, that is something not confirmed. So you can simply clip your nails whichever way you like, from the thumb to the little finger, whichever one you like to begin with. As long as you begin with the right hand, this is something that has been confirmed in the sound hadith. Also keep in mind that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered clipping one's nails as one of the traditions of the pure nature. Qassul adfar, clipping one's nails, is one of the traditions of the pure nature. Because some people, especially women, they like to grow their nails. And some even connect them with artificial nails so that they have long nails. This is not permissible in Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ has set a time as a maximum period of time that a person should not keep his nails or her nails, whether the nails of the hands or the toes, and similarly the pubic hair and the underarm hair, beyond 40 days, the maximum period. And if the person naturally grows the nails quick and fast, then every 10 days, or as some of the scholars recommended that, to do it on every Friday before offering the Friday prayer, because this is one of the means of beautifying and adorning oneself and preparing oneself to attend the Friday prayer, whether Thursday evening or Friday morning before the Jumu'ah. Some of the scholars said, even if the person forgot and didn't get to do it, didn't get to clip his or her nails on Friday before Jumu'ah, let them make it up after Jumu'ah. This is how the scholars paid close attention to the personal hygiene with regards to clipping the nails, removing the unwanted hair, the pubic hair, and the underarm hair. That's something that the Sunnah has dealt with. May Allah guide us to what is best. Sadiqa Firdaus, Sister Sadiqa says, can a Muslim eat the meat slaughtered by another Muslim who does shirk, worshipping people who are dead and their bodies are kept on the roof? You mean the tombs? Where people come on Friday and read Yasin and does all the stuff which against our religion. That is something which I have discussed before in details, which is, it isn't easy to accuse laymen of shirk or kufr because they don't know. Many people were brought up this way and they don't know that. They are not supposed to do things like that. So first of all, we have to inform them that it is not permissible to invoke other than Allah the Almighty. Yes, I have heard by my own ears people who would do the slaughtering, the sacrifice, and distributing the meat in the name of a peer or a pious person, supposedly, because I don't know whether this person was pious or not. He's dead, and he's been dead for maybe 50 years, 100 years. Nobody knows, okay? So people would slaughter the meat and cook the meat along with rice and distribute it around these areas. The sole purpose is to get the blessing of this person. Obviously, this practice is plain shirk. It's plain shirk. But unfortunately, many of those who do that, particularly the villagers, the Bedouins, are unaware of the grievous sin of slaughtering an animal for the name or in the name of other than Allah the Almighty. Then distributing the meat in the name of this person whom they assume that he's a righteous person so that he will bless them. He will bless them. This is absolutely forbidden. In the hadith, our most beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, invoked Allah the Almighty saying, O Allah, do not make my grave an idol to be worshipped after my death. Subhanallah, he invoked Allah, and that is something that many people get very offended when they go to visit the grave of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in Medina, and they find the guards. Sometimes they're kind of harsh, preventing people from making dua there or saying certain supplications, and ask them to move forward for a couple reasons. Number one, because this is not the Qibla. This is not where you're supposed to be making dua. This is where you're supposed to give salam and move on, because there is a long queue. So if that is left without attention, basically you will find people who would beg from Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, out of love. He would exaggerate in the love to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to the extent that they can treat him like Christians treated Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. And this is what happened. That's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam also said in the hadith, لَا تُطْرُونِي كَمَا أَطْرَتِ النَّصَارَ الْمَسِيحَ ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ وَلَكِنْ قُولُوا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. Al-Itra is the admiration, but exceeding the limit is forbidden. Do not exceed the limit in praising me so that you become like Christians and how they exceeded the limit in praising Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, while he is just a human being and a prophet of Allah, one of the revered prophets of Allah. The Christians have perceived him as God or son of God. So the Prophet ﷺ emphasized the fact that I'm just a human being. And do not invoke me, do not take my grave as an idol to be worshipped. And he asked Allah to prevent people from taking his grave as an idol to be worshipped after his death. So in the first degree, we're supposed to raise the awareness of the fact that our most beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam said in the sound hadith, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. This is very obvious. He had been sent in order to establish the foundation of monotheism, not to worship other than Allah. And a dua or invocation is basically the core of worship, the peak of the ibadat, the topmost part of doing any act of worship. الدعاء هو العبادة, as it is in the sound hadith. So we're neither supposed to invoke Prophet Muhammad or anyone else. We're supposed only to invoke Allah the Almighty whenever we make dua. And whenever we seek help, we're supposed to seek the help of only Allah the Almighty. I hope this message is very clear. We need to propagate this message. We need to inform the elders, the villagers, the Bedouins, that these practices, even though you inherited them from your culture, from your forefathers, but they can simply lead you outside the folds of Islam. So you gotta be very careful. Those who insist afterward on doing so, and we know that they slaughter the cattle in the name of other than Allah, do not eat their meat, period. Or they do worship other than Allah, even with a good faith. In Surah Az-Zumar, Allah the Almighty said, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. Those who have taken besides Allah, awliya. Those awliya, whether the idols or the peer or whatever they have taken as deities besides Allah, they said, مَا نَعْبُدُهُمْ إِلَّا لِيُقَرِّبُونَ إِلَى اللَّهِ زُلْفَى. We are only taking them as means of approach towards Allah. So Allah the Almighty said by the end, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي مَنْ هُوَ كَاذِبٌ كَفَّارٌ. This practice is plain disbelief. And this is forging lies against Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that's why my answer is not a shortcut answer, saying that those people are mushrikeen and do not eat their meat. But first we have to establish the proof and clarify to those people that if you insist on doing so, this act is categorized as an act of major shirk, not a minor one. May Allah guide all of us to what is best. I guess I can only read the first name. The last name is kind of hard for me to pronounce, and I don't want to mispronounce your last name, but the first name is Tahir. Tahir says, I was wondering what happens to someone who grows up in the jungle or a tribal area and never hears about Islam. Do they die as a kafir? Or does Allah pardon them because they were never taught or they never knew? Allah the Almighty is the most merciful. Yes, indeed, His mercy covers all His creatures, believers and non-believers. And He has sent to us the messengers out of mercy in order to notify us, because it's hard for the human being to find out on his or her own about Allah and about His oneness and what He wants from us. So He has sent the messengers. And He said in the Quran, وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. This ayah is an answer to your question. We're not going to punish no one without sending a messenger. Why? Those who have not heard the message are not blameworthy. They are known as Ahlul Fatra, such as those who existed between the period between sending two prophets. or they haven't heard about Allah whatsoever, like those who lived in the jungles, those who lived in the desert. And guess what? I used to think years ago, nowadays this is not happening anymore, because now everybody has a TV screen and they have an access to see and learn. But guess what? In America, in the United States of America, there are, till today, there are people who have never heard about Islam, do not know anything about Islam. And there are people who have learned a lot, but all negatives. They are sitting before Fox News day and night, or only watching 700 Club. So all what they learned about Islam is negative, lies. Likewise, Allah the Almighty will test them on the Day of Judgment. So their fate is determined, or will be determined, on the Day of Judgment after Allah will test them. Because in this life they haven't been informed, or they haven't been informed properly. And that reflects the significance and the importance of us giving da'wah to others and delivering this message, like via the screen or our brothers in PSTV, Islam Channel, guide us, Sheikh Yusuf Istis. This is the duty of the entire Muslim Ummah, and not only in English, in every possible language. The Ummah has plenty of resources, but unfortunately, as you are all aware of the fact that it is wasted on nonsense. May Allah guide us what is best. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Zahra from United Arab Emirates, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam. How are you, Sheikh?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking, Sister Zahra.
Alhamdulillah. I have got a question regarding Eid al-Zuha. In my native place, while sacrificing a sheep, they first say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and then they say the person's name, the one who is alive, not the dead one. Is this right or wrong?
Why do they say the person's name, the person whom
because
they are slaughtering, on their behalf, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay, there is...
Yeah, on behalf, yeah, exactly right.
Okay.
Like, if there are five family members and there are five sheep, they tell everybody's name. First, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, then so and so.
That's like perfectly that. Fine, no problem with that.
Is that okay?
Yes. By proxy, we do not necessarily have to slaughter on our own. It's better to witness the process of the sacrifice. In the Aqiqah, in Eid al-Adha, in the Udhiyah, in any sacrifice. But, you know, definitely a butcher or somebody else will do it. And when he says, if he pronounces the name, this is on behalf of Sister Zahra or Muhammad or Ahmed, that's perfectly fine. What matters is, وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا مِمَّا لَمْ يُذْكَرِ اسْمُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَإِنَّهُ لَفِسْقٌ. We're not supposed to eat from an animal which the name of Allah, the Almighty, was not mentioned upon its slaughter. Or the name of other than Allah, the Almighty, has been mentioned as a source of blessing. But when I say, this is on behalf of you, of anybody else, this is not tasmiyah though. This is just to confirm this sacrifice belongs to such and such person. Okay? Jazakum Allah khairan, Sister Zahra. We'll take one more question before we take a break, inshallah. We will conceal the sister's name. She says in her question, my husband converted to Islam more than 10 years ago, and unfortunately he doesn't pray shafa' and witr because they are sunnah, not fard. Okay? Well, he is right that al-shaf'u wal-witr are sunnah, and similarly all the emphatic and non-emphatic nawafil, the prayers that we pray before and after any of the five daily prayers, are all sunan prescribed by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Does it mean that they are insignificant? A lot of Muslims today, whenever you advise them to do anything, they ask, is it fard or sunnah? Is it wajib or sunnah? In the past, the companions would not ask whether it's wajib or sunnah in order to decide whether to do it or not, just to make sure that it is categorized as wajib or as sunnah. But they would do it because it's sunnah. In the hadith, The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Aisha narrated that the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to stop doing some sunan deliberately, despite the fact that he would love to do it, so that his companions would not treat it as a wajib, because they would do it all the time. But he would interrupt doing some of these nawafil so that the companions will report it as nafila, not a wajib. Just to give us ease. And nowadays people ask whether it's sunnah or wajib, so that if it is wajib, okay, we'll do it because we have to. What about the sunnah? First of all, is one's Islam complete if he doesn't pray the sunnah? Yes, it is complete if he were to fulfill the wajib properly. In the Sahih Hadith, a Bedouin came to the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and he asked about what Allah has ordained upon him. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, informed him about the 5 daily prayers. Then he said, unless if you want to give extra, tatawwa, nafila. Then he asked about fasting, about the charity, about hajj. So the Prophet ﷺ basically mentioned the 5 pillars. Every time he mentioned a fard or a mandatory act of worship, he would say, illa an tatawwa, illa an tasaddaq. Unless if you want to offer extra supererogatory prayers, extra charity, extra fasting, and so on. So the man said, while turning around and leaving, I swear to the one who have sent you with the truth, لا أزيد على هذا ولا أنقص. I shall not do extra nor less. So he said he would only do the fard, the wajib. But he said, لا أنقص. I shall do it perfect. At that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أفلح وأبيه إن صدق. He will be successful indeed if he could fulfill what he said. In another hadith, if you would like to see a person who will be among the dwellers of paradise, look at this man. The issue is, why do we pray the sunan? That is the question. According to the vast majority of the jurists, which is a sunnah? A shafi' is a sunnah. Duha is a sunnah. All the prayers other than the 5 daily prayers and Friday prayer are sunan. Okay? So why do we pray the sunnah before or after the prayer? Who would like to have a nice house in a nice compound in a nice neighborhood? I guess every one of us, the companions, would love to have a house in a nice neighborhood to drive a nice car, if there is, right? What about a house in paradise? What about a house in heaven? In the sound hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever prays regularly 12 rak'ahs every day, Allah will build a house for him in paradise. We all know the 12 rak'ahs are the 4 rak'ahs before dhuhr, 2 by 2, then 2 after dhuhr, 2 after maghrib, 2 after isha, and 2 before fajr. With regards to witr prayer, the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said that Allah the Almighty is witr and He loves al-witr. And He commanded us to pray witr as an emphatic sunnah, not as a wajib. The hadith of Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, said, أَوْصَانِ خَلِيلِي بِثَلَاثِ. One of the valuable advices, the 3 valuable advices that the Prophet, peace be upon him, enjoined Abu Hurairah to do, were وَأَنْ أُوْتِرَ قَبْلَ أَنْ أَنَامِ, to pray witr before going to sleep. Praying at least 1 rak'ah counts as qiyamul layl. It is the best to pray 3 rak'ahs, like 2 rak'ahs before with taslim, then you pray 1 rak'ah by itself. Or you pray the 3 rak'ahs all together without tashahud and in the middle. Rather, the 3 rak'ahs all together with 1 sitting for tashahud and taslim by the end. May Allah guide us to what is best. We'll take a short break and we'll be back inshallah in a few minutes. Please stay tuned. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back. We have Sister Umm Ahmed from the United Kingdom. Assalamu alaikum, sister.
Alaikum salam. My name is actually Umm Rahma.
Umm Rahma, okay. Umm Rahma, assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam. I have a question regarding organ donation. It's quite a hot topic in the UK right now because where I live, everyone is opted in to donating your organs if you were in an accident, a car accident or something, and you passed away. They automatically now take all your organs if they need them, unless you opt out. Mm. So my question is, as a Muslim, are we allowed to donate our organs? Like if our child was ill and needed another liver or something like that, are they allowed to accept it and are we allowed to donate it? And also, I heard recently they're trying to do a new, like a hand transplant, someone who's lost their leg or their hand. So can we have extra body parts borrowed from other people? That's my question.
Wa jazakum. Thank you, Sister Umm Rahma from United Kingdom. Organ transplantation based on organ donation is permissible with conditions. Number one, within one's life, is it permissible for a person to donate one of his organs or a piece of an organ, such as in the case of liver? To save somebody's life, it is permissible, provided it is mere donation without any compensation. And also provided that doctors do their job, which they do, to check out the compatibility, and that there is no risk, there is no life threat, there is no serious risk for the donor. And I have witnessed some of these cases. And also another condition, that it is inevitable for the person who receives the organ or the part of the organ to receive it, lest he will die. In this case, it is permissible, and he will be rewarded for that. After death, if the person agrees before his death to donate some of his body parts to save somebody's life, that is permissible. May Allah guide us to what is best. Assalamu alaikum. Shawana from Nigeria.
Assalamu
alaikum, Shaykh. Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, Sheikh?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking, Sister Shawana.
Sheikh, my question is it allowed when someone is in gathering with his friends to ask, maybe to introduce, maybe that person used to perform a series of nawafil prayers, and when he's with friends, he used to introduce them that maybe he used to say, I used to pray this, like dua prayer, I used to pray to us before, after, during a day. So is it allowed for one to introduce this to his friends with the intention of maybe motivating them to join him in praying so that they can also get the reward?
You said to extend the intention from just mere praying to what?
To motivate them so that you can, to introduce them to the same worship, and so that you introduce them to be praying the nawafil prayers together with you. Is it allowed?
You mean, okay, now I'm kind of confused. To pray the nawafil together, what do you mean by praying the nawafil together?
Okay, Sheikh, what I mean here is that maybe someone do perform the duha prayer.
Yeah?
Uh-huh. Then he introduces his friends. Maybe when he's with his friends, he used to say, I used to perform duha prayers. Why not join me and perform it too? It will perfect your iman, it will increase your level, and just like introduce it to your friends so that you also perform. Is it halal, or is it like you are trying to show people you are?
Okay, I guess I got your question.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I got your question. Thank you. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Sally.
Wa alaikum salam.
Go ahead.
I hope you're doing fine, Sheikh.
Just fine. Thank you for asking.
You're welcome. I have three questions, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
My first question is also about the nawafil prayers, the sunnah. Mm. Besides the 12 sunnahs that we pray, that the Prophet said house will be built for us, there's also other sunnahs. For example, if you pray four before the duha and four after, God will protect you from the fire. And is if you pray for before the loss, Allah will have mercy on you. And also, the Prophet also mentioned whoever wants to pray to before the Maghrib, whoever wants to pray, you can pray. For these types of sunnahs, is it okay that we pray every single day? Because my friend saw that I was praying it every single day, so she said the Prophet never prayed it every single day. Mm. So the best thing to do is that you pray it some days and leave it some days. But, you know, at the same time, I'm always thinking we don't know when we're going to die. So it's the best for us to pray every single day just to be safe. That's my first question.
Okay.
My second question is, if we talk behind someone's back without mentioning their names, will this still be counted as backbiting?
Do you realize what you just said? You said if you talk about somebody bad without mentioning their names, but you mentioned somebody already, صح?
Yes, that's true.
So what does it mean you speak about somebody where the audience...
I'm complaining to someone about how someone was unjust towards me.
Oh, someone is known. Is known to the audience, right?
No, he's not known. I'm just saying, like, I have a friend that did this and this to me, and she's very unjust, for example.
Okay.
This person doesn't know who I'm talking about.
Hmm.
And the third question, if we see, for example, someone homeless in the street, he's eating from the garbage, and we have food in our hands, but at the same time, he looks like a crazy man. I don't know. So I was scared to give him the food because he might, talk to us or something. So do we get a sin if we don't feed this man?
Okay. Thank you. Got your questions. Appreciate that. MashaAllah. Very good question, Sister Sally. Go ahead, Brother Muhammad from Nigeria. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Good evening, Sheikh.
Good evening to you, Muhammad. Welcome to Ask Huda.
Thank you very much. I hope you are doing really good.
Fine. Alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
MashaAllah. Actually, I have two questions to ask this evening.
Please, go ahead.
Okay, the first question goes this way. It has been like an act of, I don't really know how to put it, but in Nigeria down there, many people engage themselves in visiting some of, I don't really know what to call them, Islamic scholars or so, in order to help them figure out some things, like when they are in need of help, they don't directly... Actually, they do ask Allah for assistance, but at the same time, they used to go to visit some Islamic scholars, not really Sunnah scholars, but then I don't know who they really are in order to help them also pray for them. So I don't really know what is the validity of that in Islam.
Hmm. Okay.
So the second question is about music. I think I've asked you this question like twice or three times, but I still didn't get the answer. Maybe you would write it down and you skip it, you forget about it or something like that. So I really want to know also the Islamic stance about listening to music and the kinds of music, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, that's just the question.
SubhanAllah, Muhammad, you know, I have answered tons of questions about music, but okay, we'll answer that again, inshallah. Brother Irfan from the KSA, assalamu alaikum.
How are you, sir?
I'm fine, Akhi Irfan. Thank you for asking.
Brother, actually, I wanted to remind you, I asked a couple of questions in the last episode, but I didn't get the answer for it. So I thought maybe...
What was the question?
I should ask it again. It was about the praying in the workplace when the masjid is close by. That was my first question.
Hmm.
And should I repeat the questions once again?
I guess I remember this question, and I'm pretty sure it was not answered. You're so right. Yeah. Was there any other question?
Yeah, the second question is about the sound when it reaches the... the distance criteria to reach mosque.
Oh, yes. Now I remember these two questions. Thank you.
Yeah, these two questions, I didn't get the answers in there.
Right now, inshallah. I'm sorry, I do apologize. If the masjid is in a walking distance, then we're not supposed to pray in a workplace or at home. We're supposed to attend the prayer in congregation in the masjid. Those will be exempt, those who are working on machines or working on some systems where their attention is needed. They can take turns. So like, you know, sometimes the person has to answer the call of nature. So somebody else will be attending instead of him until he finishes his need. They take a coffee break or whatever. What we need to do is each and every one of us must understand that if the masjid is nearby and in a walking distance and you hear the adhan, there is no point of praying in a little room or in a musalla while we have in the campus a masjid that you can just walk a few steps and enter the masjid to pray. The criterion with regards to the criteria of the distance that you mentioned, I believe in India, and I ask you the distance and you say it 5 kilometers. Only if you find it easy to attend any prayer of the 5 daily prayers. Somebody who has a ride, mashallah. So he drives in less than 5 minutes, he's in the masjid. You should attend in the masjid. I don't have a ride and I cannot walk. Then you pray at home with your people, with your family in jama'ah. Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Abu Saleh from Jordan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Jazakallahu khair. The question is about also praying and adhan, etc. It was mentioned in a previous episode from you, I believe, to one of the ladies, that it's not necessary to do the adhan or iqama at home when they pray. And I understand
for women.
That.
For women.
For women, exactly. Yes. And one of the boys this evening asked me in the mosque, how about the, you know, children or men, that they have excuse? Are they allowed to pray without doing the iqama?
For men, those who do not attend the prayer in the masjid, but they heard the adhan, as you said, that they have an excuse, before praying, you should call the iqama, whether you are on your own or praying in congregation. Okay?
I understand. So that was the answer before that was concerning women only.
Yes.
Okay. The second one, please, I would like to have your input, if you would, please, sir, concerning, I was reading in the book of Ibn Baz, rahimahullah.
May Allah have mercy on him.
And he says about the adhan, that the adhan begins with Allahu Akbar and ends with La ilaha illallah. Understood. So what is your input in concerning some people, not everybody, that they have, you know, readings and etc. before and after the adhan?
Have, I didn't get that word. Have what before and after the adhan?
They could have readings and stuff, you know, before the adhan, then the adhan comes, and then after La ilaha illallah, then there will be another talk. Is that allowed?
You mean a supplication?
Anything, you know, like before the adhan or after it.
There is nothing before the adhan. But the hadith says, إِذَا سَمِعْتُمُ الْمُؤَذِّنَ فَقُولُوا مِثْلَ مَا يَقُولُ. So the actual saying will begin after the muazzin launches the takbir. Once he says, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, then all the audience, men and women, are prescribed to say after him like him exactly, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Until he says, حَيَّ عَلَى الصَّلَاةِ and حَيَّ عَلَى الْفَلَاحِ, you say, لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Then after he finishes the adhan, and after you say لا إله إلا الله after him, there is a prescribed supplication, which I will share with you. But there is nothing to be said before the adhan.
Well, that's what was my main concern. Is it allowed to have anything on the speakers before or after?
You should have said that from the beginning, yes. You mean when the muazzin particularly in our in masajid in some of the Arabic countries in the Middle East, when he holds a microphone and he makes some praises and all of that is not prescribed. Al-azanu lughatan al-i'lam. it is sufficient to declare that it is the prayer time via calling the adhan. And to be honest with you, sometimes the person who holds a microphone for 15 minutes, 20 minutes before the adhan, and he's singing or chanting, he has an awful voice. Let's say that he has a melodious voice, but hey, with my due respect, there are a lot of people who are not interested and you're invading their privacy with the microphone, with the loudspeakers. The adhan is sufficient. And similarly, after the adhan, you want to say the supplication in yourself. Okay? Jazakallahu khairan. Assalamu alaikum. Sister Suwaiba from Nigeria.
Wa alaikum assalam. Good evening, Sheikh.
Welcome to the program.
How are you, Sheikh?
Fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Yes. Please, I want to ask a question. I got some money wired into my account from the federal account, and I went to the bank to complain that it said they have no way of reversing the transaction except if it's been reversed from where it was sent from. So my question here is, how long should I keep this money? And then if it doesn't get reversed, what do I do with the money? Do I do sadaqah? Do I just consume it?
Or how much is the amount?
What do I do with the money? Yeah.
How much is the amount?
About 100,000 Nigerian naira.
Okay, yeah. You know why I'm asking you? The answer will not differ. I mean, it will not make any difference whether it's 100,000 or 100 million. Well, I just wanted to share with the viewer a condition where, correct me if I'm wrong, that you received by mistake some money was wired to your account from the federal government or from whatever, and it's 100,000 by mistake. So the amount is in your account, which is not yours. You went to the bank to complain that this money is not yours. Am I right?
Yes, and I was told they cannot reverse it until it's been reversed from where it was sent from.
Subhanallah.
I have a second question. Yes.
Subhanallah. May Allah bless you, Sister Thuwaiba. These are the traits of the true Muslim. Honesty. Honesty. Allah the Almighty says in Surah An-Nisa, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تُؤَدُّوا الْأَمَانَاتِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهَا وَإِذَا حَكَمْتُمْ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ أَن تَحْكُمُوا بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ نِعِمَّا يَعِظُكُمْ بِهِ. Indeed, Allah commands you to render back al-amanat, plural of amana, which is the trust. The sister received some money transferred to her account by mistake, and she went to the bank to complain that this money is not mine, and it is transferred or wired to her account from the federal government. Subhanallah. And she's asking what she's supposed to do and how long should she keep it if they are not willing to withdraw the money and retract or correct the mistake. If I know that the person who wired the money and I know his account, I'll just reverse it simply. But because this is a federal account and federal money, you need to follow the legal process and write down a note in the bank and to your family members, your ears, that this money, the 100 grands, are not yours. This amount of money is not yours. You're just waiting for the process so that they can withdraw their money back and correct that mistake, because this money is not yours. I wouldn't advise you to withdraw it and give it in a charity, because now you file the complaint and you ask them to correct the mistake. They can come back and say that we want to correct the mistake after you have given that money in a charity. So that money belongs to the public, not only to one person, where it makes the liability much bigger and greater. May Allah bless you, Sister Thuwaiba, for your honesty and trustworthiness. Sister Sally from Egypt asked about the non-emphatic sunnah. What is the difference between emphatic and non-emphatic? As-sunnah al-mu'akkada wa as-sunnah ghayru al-mu'akkada. As-sunnah al-mu'akkada that the Prophet ﷺ was very keen to offer. It is not mandatory, but he was very keen to offer, and he skipped it for a few times, a couple times or so, especially if he was on a journey or traveling. As-sunnah ghayru al-mu'akkada, it is a sunnah which the Prophet ﷺ recommended to do, and he used to do it occasionally, but not all the time. Whether emphatic or non-emphatic sunan, the person should observe them to the best of their abilities, because they make up any deficiency and the drawback that happens in the fard prayer. They also work on raising sins and raising the ranks of the believer and increasing one's iman. But not to the point where you do it every single day. Yani, if you skip it a couple times per year, that is sufficient. That notifies that this is not wajib, this is not mandatory, it is mere sunnah. But not to the point that you skip it and you do it occasionally. Okay? May Allah bless you, Sister Sally. We really went over time. And I understand that your questions are very valuable. Similarly, Muhammad from Nigeria. So inshallah, you, Shawana, and Muhammad from Nigeria, I shall begin next episode by answering your questions. Please accept my apology. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance.